So the next speaker is Raphaël Voiturier, who is just from Paris. And so thank you very much to be with us. And you will talk about memory inside migration. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you very much for having me here. It's a great pleasure. So as a, let me start by a disclaimer. So I'm a physicist, I'm a theorist, and I will show you mostly experimental data that I do not produce. So all the credit goes to my colleagues. So for today, it will be Mathieu Piel and Anna Maria Lennon's group from Institut Curie, Benoît Ladeau's group from Institut Jacques Monod, and Daniela Vignevic's group from Institut Curie. And I hope some credit can still go to the theorists who are listed here, and in particular, my colleague and friend Olivier Benichou and Andrew Callan-Jones. So it's a bit intimidating to start with an introduction on cell migration in front of this audience, so I'll make it brief. So I'm a physicist interested in cell migration, and typically I have two kinds of questions in mind. So the first one is very simple. What we try to understand is how do cells move from a physics perspective, which means that we are trying to build minimal physical model of what would be a cell, what would be a cell cluster, and understand what are the minimal mechanisms that can lead to motion. So if you want a very simple picture, we are trying to think of cells. So you know very well this example, maybe a bit less that one. We try to depict this type of phenotypes as a droplet of something, and we're trying to think of what are the minimal properties you need to give this something if you want to reproduce the phenomenology that you observe. And because physicists like to change scale, you can play the same game with cell clusters. So here you have a bunch of cells, maybe 20 here, that are seated on a collagen gel. This moves, and we want, again, to try to use physical model to describe this type of process. And we are dealing with coarse grained model, again, very much continuous media model description of this behavior. And the key feature is that they must be active and consume some energy in order to produce motion. So that's why it's usually called an active material, active hydrodynamic description of cell migration. So that's for the generic setting. And more precisely today, I want to discuss the impact of the environment on this type of mechanism. So you could discuss, is the environment adherent or non-adherent? Are cells confined or not? And that will be the main difference between these two phenotypes. This guy is sitting on an adherent flat hard substrate, whereas this one is in fact moving in a completely non-adherent environment, but confined between two planes. And that's what will essentially decide of the phenotypes you see. So that's why I will try to discuss today. So that's the first very simple type of question. Let me state the second one that I'm typically interested in. As long as you believe that you have some understanding of how it moves, then you can take a larger picture and look at the type of trajectory you obtain and try to discuss how efficient are these cells in moving. So that would be more like a why question. Are they efficient in fulfilling their function, which is moving? And this type of question arises in essentially on this example on two contexts. You can look at immune cells, for example. So in that case, you're looking at macrophages in a transparent fish. And these cells, their function is essentially to explore space and find intruders. And you want to be able to tell whether or not they are good at doing that. So the typical tools physicists have are essentially to describe this motion are random walks. And in this context, they belong to the class of active random walks because of self-propulsion. Then you can try to derive models that are reproducing this type of observation and make prediction on their efficiency in exploring space, for example. Of course, you can also play that game for collective migration. So that would be the second example that I will discuss, where you have a blob of cell, a blob of cancer cell lying on the collagen gel. That's very much the same setup. Again, you can try to devise random walk model to describe this trajectory and ask yourself whether or not space exploration is done in an efficient way. So that's for my question two type that I want to discuss briefly today. So more specifically, in that talk, I put the emphasis on cell-environment interaction, and I want to argue that this type of interaction can lead to what I will discuss can be called memory effect. And I want to discuss two effects. One will be a question one type of discussion. So I want to show that this interaction directly impacts on the spontaneous polarization that you can get in cell cluster. And in a second part, I'll try to discuss more the large scale properties of trajectories that can be triggered by such type of interaction. So let's start with my question one. Let's try to think of minimal mechanisms that can lead to spontaneous polarization and migration that you can have either at the single cell level or at the level of cell collective. And here, as compared to the previous talk, I'm talking about migration in absence, in complete absence of external imposed gradient. That would be spontaneous. So let me first give you previous example of what I call minimal model. And in this perspective, what I want to advertise is the use of fragments that I found very very interesting from a physics perspective, because they really are going towards minimal system. And I will start by showing this very old example, 20 years old now, of keratocyte fragments that you see here. And to me, this is still very inspiring as a physicist to look at cell migration. So here you have a fragment, so you get rid of the nucleus, you get rid of a bunch of complexities that you could have in a cell, and still these fragments, for us, it's typically membrane plus some active stuff, this active stuff being essentially the actin cytoskeleton. And you see that it is still able to define a well-defined shape, and it's still able to self-propel. So when you remove some complexity, you can still have a minimal system that is able to undergo this type of instability, switching from a perfectly non-polarized, non-motile state towards a well-polarized and motile state. So that, for me, that would qualify as a prototypical example of what could be called mesenchymal migration, meaning that you have adhesion on a hard substrate and fragments that are well spread on the substrate. So you can ask yourself whether you could get fragments for other type of migration, and I take this opportunity to advertise Mathieu Piel's work here. You can indeed get fragments that are completely non-adherent and that would move in confinement, and that provides you with very nice minimal systems of amoeboid-like migration. So that's what you get, that we get here. So these are fragments from HeLa cell that move in a collagen gel, and they are squeezed between two hard plates. And so you have another minimal system with this very nice phenotype, where again you got rid of a lot of complexity, at least nucleus and organelles. So for these two types of migration, archetypal type of migration, there has been a lot of work done, and I just want to add to show you the type of minimal model that can be done to give you an idea of the main tools that I want to use. So here I want to discuss this very nice work, so historically from Callan Jones and Carles Blanche Mercadet, to give you an idea of what is a minimal model. So in that case, inspired by this phenomenology of keratocyte fragment, their minimal description describes the fragment as a simple viscous fluid, and the only extra hypothesis that they make is that you can assemble the fluid, you can nucleate the actin cytoskeleton from the boundary, and that you do it in a completely isotropic way. And what they showed is that with this minimal ingredient, which is just assembly at the boundary, in fact, you can show that there is an instability, and spontaneously, you will get a non-trivial shape, and you will get polarity, and you will get motion. So that's an example of a minimal model, minimal in the sense that you only need to add actin polymerization to get a very simple mechanism of polarization and motion. You can play the same game for amoeboid-like motion, and that was inspired by the work by Mathieu Piel, who showed that you can get in kind of extreme condition of amoeboid migration, where you have no specific adhesion at all, and where you have confinement, so you end up with this type of phenotypes that are mostly triggered by actin contractility. And what you find is, again, you get actin flow, so you get actin dynamics that sets in, and you can ask yourself a similar question. If you start with a minimal description of the actin myosin cortex, under which condition can you find a switch from a purely symmetric state towards a polarized motile state? And a bunch of us in this audience have been working in this type of model, and at the end of the day, we all find that by increasing contractility, indeed, you can define such spontaneous symmetry breaking and have a spontaneous definition of polarity and motion. So that's typically this this type of model that were devised for the to explain single cell migration. What I want to emphasize is that here polarity is defined from an instability of the actomyosin cytoskeleton. It's completely defined from the perspective of the cell itself. So now what I want to discuss is an example where, in fact, you do not see any such polarity, but you still do find globally a very persistent migration. And so this example comes from Daniela Vinjevic's lab, who was working on this cancer cell cluster that were seeded on a collagen gel. And you can look at what happens to this this cluster. So it's a bunch of cells, say 20. So here you have a top view and here a side view of this cluster. And you can see that they move quite persistently, meaning that they keep that direction of motion for quite a while. And the type of random walk description, if any in that case, would be that of a standard persistent random walk. So you can make this quantitative and look typically at the mean square displacement, so that would be my red plot here, and you have the typical crossover from a ballistic-like motion at short time scale, and that crosses over to diffusion. So that's quite standard, okay, all good. So the question was, if I see this type of persistent motion, I must find some type of polarity cue at the level of the cluster to instruct the cluster of where to go. What gives the cluster the definition of the direction of motion? So we did. They did what is usually done in that case. You're looking for whatever polarity Q that could be non-uniformly distributed in the cluster. So the typical candidate are myosin, that could be RAC, for example. And if you look at the distribution, for example, of myosin around, so it's mostly localized at the periphery of the cluster. But now if you look at the distribution with respect of the direction of motion, it's perfectly uniform. You do not get any Q by looking only at the myosin distribution in the cluster, even though you do find a cluster that moves in a very persistent way. If you look at RAC activity, same story. You have something which is almost perfectly uniform all around the cell cluster, and you have no idea of where the cell would go. So here, by definition, we know that the cluster moves toward the north. However, if you look at RAC distribution, it is perfectly uniform. So of course, it's very hard to make a negative proof. So we cannot make the claim that there is strictly no polarity Q. But we've been looking at microtubule organization. You can define shape descriptors. There is strictly no apparent asymmetry, so no obvious definition of polarity by looking only at the cluster itself. So that was sort of the puzzle. And again, in contrast to the usual models where the polarity really comes from internal degrees of freedom. So where could that come from? So the idea was to look at the environment. And if you image now the collagen, what you see is this type of motion, and you see that the collagen gets deformed quite a lot. And here you can track the intensity of the collagen. And if you look more closely, in fact, you can build a vector that will be my polarity. And this vector, how is it defined? You go from the cluster center of mass to the collagen density center of mass. So that's my red arrow here. And if you do that, in fact, you do find that on average, you have a systematic shift between the peak of collagen density and the center of mass of the cluster. So that qualifies, at least for a physicist, that qualifies as polarity. You've built a vector, but this time you need to have the information coming from the environment. If you look only at the cell cluster, there is no such a thing. So here, the polarity, you can define the polarity, and the velocity of the cluster is very well defined by taking the opposite of this polarity vector. That works fine. So you can define this polarity, but thanks to the interaction with the environment. So why? And the idea is that, you know, if you still assume that the cluster itself has no polarity, the cluster will, of course, interact with the environment, but if the source of the perturbation that it induces in the environment is perfectly symmetric, there is no reason to get an asymmetry in the response. In fact, the only way to do that is if you get a delay. So the hypothesis was that, in fact, if the response of the environment is delayed as compared to the source of the perturbation, then in principle, you can get such lag in space and get a definition of polarity. So the idea was to challenge the viscoelastic response of the medium, which takes some time to relax. and check whether or not this is indeed the key point to define a polarity. So to do that, you can build this setup here where you have a similar molecular contact. You still have collagen, but not polymerized, only monomeric and directly laid onto the substrate. And in that case, in fact, so you have roughly the same chemical content, but you sort of killed the viscoelastic response of the collagen gel, and you find something that completely loses persistence if you compare to the case where with polymeric collagen. So in fact, it seems that physical properties of the environment are crucial in that case to induce persistent migration. And to sort of identify this my story of having a delay, we try to directly measure this delayed response, and that in fact you can do by looking at the collagen. So it goes quite fast. So here you rinse with trypsin, so you kill the cluster at t equals zero, and you're looking at the collagen density. And if you look closely enough, when it starts, you do have this relaxation that you can measure, and you get a typical relaxation time out of this measurement, which is about 5 to 10 minutes. So indeed, the collagen has a viscoelastic response with a delay. And the idea was, okay, thanks to this delay, you can get, in principle, polarity, even if the cluster itself has no internal polarity at all. That would come from the coupling. So to make this a little bit formal, and here I give you the simplest version of a possible description that you can make. So we assume that the cluster is perfectly symmetric, but it will typically pinch the substrate. So it imposes a source of deformation G, which is perfectly symmetric. That's what you get here. And the idea is that the substrate will deform, and this response, we assume a very simple viscoelastic response that you can rephrase in terms of this kind of simple evolution. The key point is that you have a delay, tau R, you have a given time that monitors the delay in the mechanical response that you get in your environment. So that's the action of the cluster on the substrate, and in turn, we assume that the cluster itself would respond if it experiences any gradient in the perturbation in the substrate. So that's typically seen. If you would impose a gradient of stiffness, a gradient of density, a gradient of order, you would get a response. So here the idea is that in fact you have a self-generated feedback between these two. So what is the picture? Then the picture that you can get out of this quite simple model is that in fact if the relaxation time is too short, what you will do is that in fact the cluster will pinch locally, so you have a source of perturbation and the response is instantaneous. So you have something that remains perfectly symmetric and the cluster would not know where to go. But now if you assume that you have a delay and technically you find that there is a threshold in the delay, what you find is that in fact it is possible that the cluster pinches locally the gel, it creates a bump, and if it moves, in fact it can go away from the top of the bump and in fact surf down the slope that it has created in the past. And there, in that case, you do find a solution which is well polarized, so you can define a polarity. You have a steady state solution at a finite speed v. So that's very much this delay that will create the polarity in that case, in this, again, very, very simple picture. So how to challenge that? I mean, the idea was to tune this relaxation time, and you can do that by cross-linking the collagen, so you have different chemical treatments that can lower this relaxation time, and by lowering chemically the relaxation time, we do find that, in fact, this lag, this shift from the max of the concentration of the collagen and the center of mass of the cluster, you can reduce this shift, so you can reduce the polarity as we define here, and if you put numbers, that works fine, and you lose completely polarity if the gel responds too fast. And looking at trajectory, you do have something that switches from persistent Vandermoog in the case where the collagen has a long enough response, and if you lower this response time, you end up with something that completely loses any polarity. So that shows you that indeed this relaxation time is what controls persistence, and this is what can build polarity in your system by coupling the cluster to the environment. So that's my first example that tells you that in fact even if the system itself that you're looking at is not polarized, in fact, through an interaction with a more complex environment, you can get a self-generated polarity cue. So why do I want to call that memory? It can sound a bit overstated and pedantic. I'm just referring to very basic definition that are used in statistical physics. So here, I just want to mean that you cannot get a simple Markovian description of your dynamics. What does it mean? It just means that if you give me at some observation time the state of the system, the position of the cluster, I am not able to predict its future. Why? Because it will depend on the past, as simple as that. That's what I will call memory. I need to have information of the past if I want to predict the future. That's what is called non-Markovian or memory in this context. And here, indeed, my cluster, they leave a trail. This trail is short-lived, but I need to know where the trail was if I want to tell where the cluster would go. So that's a first example. And in the remaining time, I want to switch to a second example where this type of memory will be much more long-lived and will have drastic consequences on the large-scale exploration of my cluster. So just as a kind of disclaimer, when you're talking about memory in living system, you have tons of reasons to get memory, okay? Cell cluster, they could have memory effects, aging effect, which means a dependence on the observation time because of cell cycle, the transcriptional state. That's perfectly fine. I'm just arguing that you can also have similar effects only through interaction with the environment, and that's my point today. So let me switch to my second story, which is a question two-like problem. I'm looking now at a larger scale at trajectories, and I will go to single cells. So this one comes from Benoît Ladoux's group, and in fact, one of his postdocs, Joseph D'Alessandro, came to me to discuss this quite nice phenomenology where you have single MDCK cells on an adhesive fibronectin line, and the observation was this type of oscillatory-like behavior. So there is kind of a long history of spontaneous oscillation in cellular systems. So the first question was, where could that come from? And in fact, looking at long-time trajectories, so here you have a chymograph of the cell going up and down, up and down, up and down. In fact, what you see is that it sort of slowly evolves in time, and looking at that, you do not really feel that there is an internal clock that is deterministic behind that, simply because the amplitude slowly evolves in time. So the idea was maybe it's not, in fact, the usual type of deterministic oscillation that people have observed in cell system. Maybe there is something else behind. And the idea, of course, is I want to make the connection of my story of making a perturbation in the environment. The idea was, in fact, it looks as if the cell is, in fact, going at a constant speed, but each time it goes to the end of the previous amplitude, it slightly overshoots, reverses the direction, and keeps going like that with slightly overshooting the previous max. So that was sort of the intuition we got. And if you look at more carefully at the polarity, in fact, you can look at RAC1 activation that defines the polarity. You have the feeling that, in fact, indeed, you have polarity reversal, and these events are almost always located at the same position in space. So that might be instructed by something in the environment rather than an internal clock. So that was the idea, looking at that. So the idea to challenge this hypothesis, so the hypothesis, I mean, I spoil it right away, was that, in fact, the cell makes a perturbation on the environment that is long-lived and that will feed back on its direction of motion. So the idea is that cells deposit footprints, essentially. So how to challenge this hypothesis? In fact, that was quite simple. So you do the similar setup, except that now you will have what we call a conditioned environment, which means that you let cells go for a while over all the tracks so that they will cover all available space, and then you redo the experiment, you rinse, and you redo the experiment with a single cell. So you can compare what happens when the cell explores a fresh environment to what happens when the cell explores an environment that has already been visited by someone else. And when you do that, I mean, you don't even need to quantify almost, so you have the control on top and the condition in the bottom, you see something that has completely nothing to do. You completely lose on the condition substrate if the track has already been visited. The cells essentially go persistently for hours and they never oscillate. So you can make that quantitative, but again, the effect is so striking. So there is a very, very clear difference if you compare an assay where the environment has never been visited to an assay where it has already been visited. And you can do that in 2D. So in 2D, you do not have clean oscillation. Oscillation really come from the one-dimensional setting, but you still have a very clear difference between the controlled case, fresh environment, and the conditioned environment. So that tells you that yes, over long time scale, exploring or not the environment can have a very deep impact on migration properties. So let's try to make that a little bit quantitative, because so far it was sort of a hypothesis. So to sort of make this hypothesis more quantitative, it was hard to identify the footprint. So we don't aim at identifying specifically the footprint, but the idea was that at least in the data, what we can monitor is an indicator of the fact that the space has been visited. So we just counted the cumulative time spent at some position. So that's here the color plot. And what you find is that if you look at a cell trajectory now, you can look at where are the polarity reversal events, and they all fall on this line where you have a very steep gradient of this index. So it means that you do have a cue which instructs the cell of reverting polarity where it faces a sharp gradient of cumulative time spent, which means that if it's facing a territory that it has never seen, it will by far prefer going back to something it has already seen. So we try to identify what is this footprint, and that's a complicated question. So we can tell that indeed these cells they drop fibronectin and laminin, but these are not necessary ingredients. So they do contribute to this footprint, but these are not the magic cue that does the job. So typically, if you silence cellular fibronectin production, you still get a similar effect. It is reduced, but it is still there. So it's probably a combination of many things. It could be not purely chemical, but a mechanical remodeling of the matrix that does the job. So because I'm getting close to the end, I just want to argue now that this effect of footprints, in fact, has a very strong impact in terms of exploration. So here I just present you the very simple choice of model we did for this effect, but it belongs to a much broader class. But just to set the stage, let me briefly describe this one-dimensional version of the model. So the idea is that you take, in a discrete setting, your favorite random walk model. So here, it was a persistent, very simple persistent random walk model. Now what you want to add is that, in fact, your cell will interact with some effective potential, and this effective potential depends on the total number of visits that you have made. So in that case, you count how many times you have visited this site, so that's your green variable, and you make an effective potential that depends on this variable. And here, we took a very simple step function, meaning that you prefer sitting on spots that you have already visited as compared to fresh sites. So that gives you a gradient here, which means a force that would pull you back towards the visited territory. So that's a very simple model that you can build, and that recovers the observation in that case. But I'm not making a big fuss about the model itself. What I want to emphasize to conclude is that, in fact, this class of model, it belongs to a much broader class, which are called self-interacting random walks, that emerged essentially some 40 years ago, introduced by Parisi and Pelletti. And the idea was sort of inspired by all these, for example, ants that deposit pheromones. So the idea is that you deposit cues, but they are not soluble. So they do not diffuse, they are static, and they remain for very long. And the idea is that you deposit stuff that you can interact with. And you enter in a zoo of random walks that have completely different properties as compared to usual diffusion. So if you want the basic rule, it's very simple. You can build a lattice walk, and you just say that your transition probability to the next site, they in fact depend on the total number of visits that you have made in the past. So that makes the random walk completely non-Markovian. You have very strong memory effect because you need to have the full information of all the territories that you have explored in the past in order to define the future. And so I will close with the effect that you get out of that. So both in experiments and in the model, this simple feature that you interact with your own trail has a very deep impact in the exploration. So so let's look at experiments. If you compare control to condition experiments, so here I'm looking at the mean square displacement, and the color stands from different observation time. So the very first striking and super important effect is that you get aging, which means that if you do your experiment, you measure your displacement at time zero, you get something of that sort. But if you come one day later, you have something that has nothing to do. Okay, it is aging because the territory explored has been evolving meanwhile, and that completely changes the type of trajectory you get. So this is aging, and if you compare both, you have a dramatic slowdown when the cell must explore a fresh environment as compared to a conditioned environment. So that's a very drastic feature that you also find in dimension two. And if you look at this class of model, In fact, you can predict that you even expect sub-diffusion, so you change scalings, and you can even get complete trapping of your exploration. So I guess I must close here. So these are the conclusions. So I discuss two effects of what I call memory. And again, I don't want to make a big fuss about the word. It's a very down-to-earth physics meaning that just says that an evolution depends on the past. That's all what I'm saying. And in the first effect, this was crucial to define polarity. And in the second one, I hope I show you that it can deeply impact exploration properties of sets. So thank you very much.